Your world is upside down. That's why we start to fall. From this heavy spin, bouncing, bouncing ball. How much did you drink before you make a call? Your world is upside down. That's why we start to fall. You drink and die. Your Nazi gold was stolen all throughout the war. Now you have the virus, for there is no cure. But all you say that it's not funny anymore. Your world is upside down, that's why we start to fall. You drink and die.
Right, hello everybody, this is Steve from the Retro Man blog, and we're pleased to welcome into the pod today two members of the Fallen Leaves. We have
Rob Simmons, guitarist,
and Rob Green, the singer.
Hello, Robs, and also we're joined by Mr. Rock photographer Paul Slattery.
Good evening.
Yeah, good evening, thanks hello, for coming in.
But your first gig was in the football ground.
Yeah.
A very episodic place to play.
Brentford Football Ground, the home of West London football.
Absolutely, indeed. You're dead right there, Rob.
Well, we can see the ground from here.
Yeah.
In fact, you can read your paper in the back garden with
you
the
can.
Floodlights.
That's a famous quiz question, did you know that? What football league ground has a pub on every corner? Answer, Griffin Park.
That's right.
And here.
I've been in all of them after one game.
He's been banned from all of them as well.
But it is true, the first show we ever played was at Griffin Park.
Well, that was when Paul was still with us and we were supporting him.
And then what about the Monks Club together in Richmond? Was this somewhere that you played? And is it true that Ronnie Wood was there on your...
Yeah, no, it's not true, it's not the Monk Club.
Oh, the Parliament Club.
Yeah, very briefly. The Monk Club was there was a friend of ours who was putting on a really kind of avant-garde kind of, you know, bits of poetry, bits of book readings and a bit of music in the basement that was a homeless shelter.
Mm-hmm. It's a church.
It's a church in Richmond Hill.
Yeah.
But what really appealed... Well, he was a friend of ours also, but what really appealed to us was that this was proper live, amplified music in Richmond. And so we played there, and then we wanted to put on our own shows. So we found a pub in Richmond, which is now sadly gone. And we, so far as we know, we were the last people putting on amplified beat music in Richmond. You can still do it in Twickenham, but in Richmond itself. And we put on our own nights there, so Billy Childish played with us there. Famous underachievers like ourselves, the Downliners sect, played there. And because they were old mates with Ronnie and his brother, Art Wood would come on and sing a couple of songs with the Downliners sect. Sadly, he's now departed, Art. Mm.
Yeah.
And Ronnie got up and played a bit of guitar with the Downliners sect. So he appeared at our club, yeah.
Mm. Oh,
he's very short.
He is, tiny. Art wasn't that big either.
No, they're all short.
Yeah.
But don't allow tall people to Rolling Stones because it makes the others look too short.
The Art was the first rock band I ever saw at Ilpire Island.
Oh, fantastic. Mm. Well, I think the idea was that people thought Art Wood was going to be much more famous than Ronnie, you know.
It was
he was going to be the big star, wasn't he?
I think back in the day, you know, the Art Woods were going to be the next big thing, I thought, from Richmond.
And the Downliners sect played, you know, roughhouse R&B. They were still playing the way they'd been playing 40 years before, which was fantastic. You know, you do what you do and you keep doing it and you do it well. And they did it and so, you know... And they came from our neck of the woods, so that's the connection with Richmond.
Okay. So talking about Ilpire and Richmond, then what was this true again about Pete Townshend offered you some studio time?
Yeah, that's true, yeah.
How did that come about? How did he find out about the band?
Paul had known because Paul was in the Professionals with Steve Jones and Paul Cook. Steve Jones and Paul Cook knew Pete Townshend.
Okay.
I think the famous story, isn't it, where they met at the speakeasy and Pete Townshend was drunk and said he's going to disband the Who, and they said, oh, well, that's a fantastic group, you can't do that. Yeah. So they knew Pete Townshend, and Paul met them through the link with the... After they left the Sex Pistols, they formed the Professionals with Paul Myers.
Okay.
So Paul... And so, you know, Pete Townshend lives in Richmond, you know, I see him stopped in coffee shop and things. Paul used to see him in town, and I think he just called him up.
I think initially we thought we were just going to go there to rehearse,
and somehow it sort of turned out that he was going to have someone in there we could record in the Yulpi studios.
Yeah, I think he gave us 5 hours or something. So we recorded the single and the EP, which was the first thing we released. That was all recorded in 5 hours. Because he gave us 5 hours free. That was virtually live. It was very nice of him. Yeah, very, very nice of him.
And this became The Trouble.
Indeed. EP. Yeah.
Well, let's hear the title track now. Let's hear Fallen Leaves and Trouble. Your very first single, or well, EP, called that was a title track called Trouble, recorded in Pete Townshend's studio. Was that the Yulpi studio?
Yeah.
And talking about the, you know, Pete Townshend, again, West London boys, was he a big influence on your music as well?
Well, because I've got the two older brothers, my brother used to go to the Marquee to see The Who every week, and we had all of their singles at home. So I sort of, when I was very, very young, I was grew up with Can't Explain and My Generation and all of those songs, and we had that My Generation LP. I heard it on the sort of family stereogram. That became my sort of childhood music. I remember buying Happy Jack for my brother for his birthday present.
And you picked Happy Jack as your choice of Who song?
I sort of introduced a bit Rob to The Who and played in that song. He tried to sort of copy it again a bit.
Yeah.
And we came up with this song, which was a bit...
So dare we ask which song...
Yeah, Is She Somewhere?
Right, okay.
Because what The Who have got, I think, is they've got power, lots of power, and there's still a power to be reckoned with, The Who. You see them live, there's still a power. They've got power, but they've also got melody and lots of la-la-la-la-la-las. And so it's a good combination.
Yeah.
And I think they've also got that thing of just one guitar, one bass, and drums. Yeah, you know, the Yardbirds and the Stones, all that had those two guitars and sort of extra But Who were the first of those sort of groups just be really, really just one guitar, bass and drums. Yes.
But really powerful with one guitar. Oh, yeah. Really powerful. Feel good, one guitar.
What was happening with The Who at the time is that each record they were releasing was becoming a little bit more complex. The production was becoming amazing, and Happy Jack, the production of that is just superb.
It's a very unusual song.
Yeah.
The beat of it changes. The drumming is so important in that song. if it hadn't been for Keith Moon, you couldn't have made a song like that, because the drumming is just so important on the Happy Jack.
Don't you think the Happy Jack also is like where they might have got the idea of doing the opera stuff, because it is like that mini opera in the one song.
It is. You know, it's always
where they start to change.
Yeah, but it works when it's 3 minutes. Because it's story. Yeah, 30 minutes, it's not so good.
Yeah,
it's a story. It's a little mini story in one song, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, one connection I think or similarity between us and The Who is often people think we're being contrary when we say this, but we really mean it. You get that stupid old kind of rock and roll joke about what's the definition of a drummer, you know, a bloke hanging about with a bunch of musicians. We actually believe the complete opposite. We have always said that you only really want one musician in your group, and that's the drummer. Because they're the ones that drive it along. And if you've got a good drummer, you don't have to be technically brilliant elsewhere, because they hold it together. So we're the complete opposite of what everybody else says.
Great, let's hear it now. Let's hear Happy Jack by The Who.
Happy Jack wasn't old, but he was a man. He lived in the sand at the Isle of Man. The kids all would sing, he would take their army. So they rode on his head with their furry donkey. They never stopped Jack in the water lapping, and they couldn't distract him from the seagulls flapping. Kids couldn't hurt Jack, they tried. They dropped things on his back and light. Stop Jack and all the water lapping, and they couldn't prevent Jack from feeling happy.
Right, now we're going to play a track from your second album, That's Right. This is called Is She Somewhere? And you're saying there's a little bit of a link up between Happy Jack and this song.
Yeah, I mean, I tried to nick it. Is really the truth of it. I think most people do that. I think we're just a bit more honest about it. You know, I liked Happy Jack. I tried to nick it, came up with something different, which is what always happens. So it's not actually the same as Happy Jack. But in order to get a link to it, like a kind of an in-joke, at the end of Happy Jack, you hear Keith Moon say, I saw you. So we decided...
Townshend, I think.
Oh, is it Townshend, is it? Yeah. Saying, I saw you. So we got Rob to stand in the studio and say, I saw you, at the end. But I thought he said it too late, so you can hear me opening the studio door, laughing and saying, that's too late, Rob. And we decided to leave it in.
Excellent. Well, let's hear it. This is She Somewhere?
Thank you.
So talking about your second album, this is another great track taken from That's Right, and this is called Go Now.
On every stepping stone I step, cracks are wide and yet still walking towards pleasure.
Go Now from the second album, That's Right. And one influence that you mentioned that I was quite surprised about was Rolf Harris.
Well, yeah.
Now, and this is actually a good little track. This is I'm a Man.
I Know a Man.
I Know a Man, sorry. And you did a new song called I'm a Man, is that right?
That's right, yeah, which I've stolen a line from this song. Ah. Rob doesn't like it. Yeah, I mean, I didn't choose it to be deliberately contrary. I chose it because I think it's a very good song.
Rob's always spoke to me about this song for many, many years. What a great song. Of course, I could never, ever hear it because it just wasn't available anywhere until sort of YouTube came along and then someone...
But the funny thing is, this is a great little track because it's like Rolf Harris trying to be serious. It's like trying to do a little 60s
music thing.
Sort of thing you'd hear on like an Austin Powers out film. Yeah. But it's actually quite a dark little lyric.
Yeah, it is indeed,
about
yeah.
jealousy and about his girlfriend wants to run off with a rich man and he wants to kill him.
I've never heard it.
Right, well, let's hear it. This is Rolf Harris and...
I Know a Man.
Yeah.
Again at the same time.
I know a man who's so rich that he says he's gonna take you from me. I know a man who's so rich that he's got me scared as can be. I look for a hideout where we could hide away, but I'm so scared my hair is turning to grey. I can't find a place that's gonna do. And he says he'll show all his money to you. I know a man who's so rich that he's coming here to take you from me. I know this man, he's someone who's gonna bring us all this misery. I'd like to shoot him dead and spend all his money on you. But if I do, and the law gets me too, what will your life be to you? You gotta tell this man, my honey lamb, to take all his money and scram.
Well, what do you think of that? That was Rolf Harris with I Know a Man. That was Rolf as a Garage Nuggets 60s pop icon. But it was a great little track, wasn't it?
He's the Billy Childish of his day. Painter, singer,
well, now
poet.
We know but there's a lot of the fallen leaves in
moustache,
there. Moustache.
Yeah. Wildlife lover.
Yeah. But I like the way he had to do a bit of vocal didgeridoo on it. He couldn't stop himself.
At the end,
you know, imagine the record company saying, right, put the bloody didgeridoo away, Rolf, let's be serious. But he can't stop himself from doing a bit of didgeridoo. But great track, you know, and that's a good choice. And actually, I know when you suggested that, I thought, yeah, but when you listen to it, there's a quite a bit of Fallen Leaves in there, you know.
It is, but I don't think Rolf ever did another song like that one, did he?
No.
No, I mean, it wasn't picked as a joke. It was picked because I think it's not Rob's favourite, but, you know, I just think it's a great song.
Yeah.
Rob has liked that song forever.
Forever.
Yeah. He's always spoken to me about that song.
Yeah. My parents had it. That's how I heard it. Right. My mum and dad bought it.
No, but it's a good choice. Yeah. And like I said, if you were to hear that on Lenny K's Nuggets, and you didn't know who it was, you think that's a nice little tune.
Yeah, but we can
tell from the vocalist Rolf, though, yeah, can't you?
Well, we can tell.
I do like Rolf Harris. Yeah. I loved him as a child when he did his paintings.
Yeah. Can you tell what it is, yeah?
Can you tell what it is? Yeah. It's a new Fallen Leaves song. Before we go into a couple more Fallen Leaves tracks, let's pick another one of your influences. This is another good one. This is Johnny Allen and Promised Land.
My home in North Virginia, California, on my mind. I spent a land Greyhound rolling on a rolling board across Caroline. We stopped in Charlotte, we bypassed Rock Hill, we never once a minute late. 90 miles out of Atlanta by sundown, rolling across the Georgia State. Right away I bought me a through train ticket right across Mississippi clean. I was on that midnight flight, smoking in New Orleans. Somebody help me get out of Louisiana, help me get to Houston town. There are some folks who care a little about me and they won't let the poor boy down.
And that was Johnny Allen with a great bit of Cajun rock and roll called Promised Land. And that a bit of a surprising choice, but I like that. It's a good...
Yeah, just a good, powerful song. I don't know anything about Johnny Allen or Cajun. I just remember it being a hit and I really liked it. And Rob loves it too.
I remember it from sort of pre-punk days. There was a radio show, Paul, the Charlie Gillett Show. There wasn't much to listen to in those days, was there?
Well, that was on...
70s, about 74, 75. And that was the one I used to play on that Charlie Gillett Show. First
he probably made
Roadrunner on.
Yeah, that's right. And that was on his own record label, Oval Records.
Oh, right.
And he was the guy who also put out Alfie and Donna's Top Ranking.
Oh, Uptown Top Ranking.
Yeah, on that same record label. Oh, so right. He didn't put out too much on that, but he put out what he liked. Anyway.
Who, Charlie Gillett?
Charlie did,
yeah. Oh, that would have been later. Mm. Yeah.
It was a great track. Yeah, it's a good choice.
Jungle Rock he used to play on that show.
Yeah. Jungle Rock, Hank Mazzell.
Yeah, that's great.
When I first saw Joe Strummer, we talked about Promised Land. I said I liked that one, and he loved that song as well.
And now let's go back to Fallen Leaves and talk a little bit about, I mean, obviously now we've got 50% of the Fallen Leaves, so tell us about the other members you've got, who is in the band at the moment, because I know you tend to go through your bassists and your drummers.
We do, we go through a few, or they go through us, I'm not quite sure which it is, but we are pretty settled and very happy with the, we've got a new drummer called William. Who has been around the block a bit, and he's been fantastic for us, and he's a rock solid drummer, which is what we want, and our bass player, who we call the Marquis of Carabash, but I think his real name's Matthew Karras, I believe, and he's been with us a while, and it's a real committed unit.
Yeah, you've got a great band. And then the drummer, I mean, I've picked up from the last gig the broken drumsticks that were shattered in front of us, so I mean, he's a great drummer, and again, Matthew's a good bass player because you've got a good image. You know, I like the look of the band.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that was what struck me, that you've got this lovely sort of English cravats and tweed and smoking jackets, and it's such a great image.
A bit of velvet.
And a good look, a bit of crushed velvet.
Yeah, we call it punk rock for gentlemen.
Yeah. It's good. And I think all the band look great live, you know. Mm. And I like your tea ceremony with your thermos flask.
Yeah.
And you were saying earlier that you used to do that, but with a cigarette. But you can't obviously.
You're not allowed to do that anymore. Stuff. Yeah. Well, I used to roll a cigarette during one of Rob's the solo in Shining. But then when the smoking ban came in, I decided to do my only other vice, which is to drink tea.
And I was asking you earlier again: is it really tea?
It's really tea.
It's really not Jack Daniels. We love our tea.
Yeah. And it's proper tea. It's not any of those teas with funny names. It's proper brewer's tea, which I'm drinking right now, supplied by Mr. Paul Slattery very kindly.
Yes, we can vouch for that. So you're going to get your next tour sponsored by PG Tips.
That would be nice, wouldn't it? Yeah.
But it's good. It's a great look. And it's a good band, you know, and I think you've got a great little unit there.
Well, the two new members, they understand, well, they're not that new, but they understand, you know, I came out with a quote when we did an interview very similar to this in America, and he said, look, the DJ said, explain to me how you get it so, I can't remember what he said, but, you know, how do you get it down to what it is? And I just came out saying, and I said, if you want your roses to grow, you've got to cut them back. And that's what we believe. You have to cut it back and cut it back and cut it back, because it's the bare bones that matter. And we don't want tons of overdubs. We don't want it spend days mixing a record. We record it. It's all mixed in a day and then we release it. Yeah. So that's how things grow. You cut them back and they grow.
Yeah, that's a good philosophy.
And then they support us in that. I mean, Bill's been coming sort of brand new, really. It's come in with, and I mean, Ian was very big boots to fill when Ian left. I think Ian was very good as well, but Bill's come in and he's got it straight away. He knows what we want, and he's inspired us a bit, really. He's sort of lifted our game.
He has. I must say that a couple of gigs at the 12 Bar have been fantastic.
And Paul mentioned the 12 Bar Club, and you're doing a regular club night now called Minimum R&B.
Yeah,
at the 12 Bar in Denmark Street, and where you play and you sort of have some of your friends playing as well, and you choose some bands to support you. And that's been great, hasn't it? I mean, that's a perfect venue for you to play. I love that venue.
What a great venue.
You know,
it's a fantastic venue.
Yeah.
I mean, it's under a bit of threat at the moment.
It is.
I can imagine. You know, you've got all the development of going around Tom Court Road, and there's this lovely old street, you know, Denmark Street, Tin Pan Alley.
Yeah.
And it will be such a shame if that gets demolished.
And, of course, that is the old forge from 1672.
Something like that.
1642. Yeah. It's a very, very old building.
It is,
in the centre of London.
It would be an outrage if they were allowed to pull that down.
It would be an outrage. Well, I think it would be a disgrace if they could pull Denmark Street down, quite honestly, because that has such a lot of history in the British music scene.
Yeah, where we play, right opposite, used to be Regent Studios, where I think the Rolling Stones recorded their first couple of albums. The Pistols used to rehearse there and
that's the famous rookery, the place no go, that was Gin Lane, that was Hogarth's Prince, all that area, Giles, and the church opposite.
That's a
fantastic area.
Yeah, it's great.
It's a fantastic club. We love playing there. Yeah. I mean, it's home for us, really.
Yeah, it's a great place, and we recommend anyone getting down there. 12 Bar Club in Denmark Street, specifically on the first Wednesday of every month,
where we
have Minimum R&B. And this is sort of developed from your Parliament Club days.
Yeah.
Where you put on some sort of, you know, good bands, didn't you? I mean, we mentioned Downline the Sect you had on.
Yep.
You've had Len Price 3, which we know, past tense.
Yeah, TV Smith.
TV Smith you've had, and
John's Children. Billy Childish a couple of times.
If anybody's listening and don't know John's Children, if you find them out on wherever you can find them, they had some fantastic singles. Fantastic singles.
But John's Children was some Mark Bolan's first band.
Yeah, but very English.
Yeah.
Which we like, very English.
And John's Children were the original group that literally couldn't play either.
Let's turn on a groovy beat one more time. Yeah, the mind-bending sound of John's Children for the last time on today's show. Another number written by Mark Bolan, who we were talking about earlier, and it's Hot Rod Mama.
Hot Rod Mama moving like a motorcycle, never in a race. Hot Rod Mama moving like a motorcycle, devil in a race. Well, I'm blown out my mind, I can't keep up the pace. On a grand, I
I think they're pretty much sort of overlooked, aren't they?
Really? Very overlooked.
From that sort of the sort of mod. I mean, they weren't a mod band as such, were they? Sort of garage mod. They were.
They're worth checking out. Yeah.
They had a great. There were
two or three fantastic singles.
Mm. Right. I'd read about them, you know, in like Bam Blam magazine before punk and everything. I was absolutely obsessed by them, but never heard. You couldn't, because in those days you couldn't buy any records or anything. They'd all been deleted. Yeah. You couldn't get hold of anything.
Wow. Yeah, I think they.
But just reading about them, they couldn't play. They've had their own group. They had their own club, the Blues Club in Leatherhead. They wore all white. You know, had their own thing. They had those sort of Hell's Angels around as sort of bouncers. I was fascinated by them. Didn't hear anything by them.
Yeah, they're one of those sort of bands like the Action as well. Like one of those bands that were always sort of overlooked. The mod scene and that, you know, but. You know, it's like, and that's a downliner sect again, you know. I mean, people talk about...
But they had great song titles, you know, Smash Blots.
Yeah, it's great.
Well, certainly, you're right, Stick, they're part of that tradition that we love of being kind of glorious underachievers. Mm. You know, the Who took their mantle and ran with it, and, you know, but their legacy is well worth listening to.
Yeah,
when we put them on, that was the very last show that their drummer... Chris Townsend, wasn't it? The last show he ever played, and then unfortunately he got cancer and he died. So, you know, it was a great privilege to...
And a fantastic drummer. Well, if you listen to their singles, do you know them? You've got to dig out some... The drumming sound is fantastic, it's unbelievable. And Phil, our bass player, was at the time, then did a Mark Riley session with them. Played with them for a few shows, and they went up and did a Mark Riley session. That's probably available.
That's good.
Well, Phil will have it.
And he was the only... I think there's a story about... I think Keith Moon was ill or something, and the Who were booked to do some European tour, and they said the only other drummer that we're prepared to do it with was Chris, isn't that right?
He definitely played with them.
He did two or three shows.
But they supported the Who on a European tour, but they out-pooed the Who and were thrown off the tour.
Yeah.
But there was riots in the venues in Germany after them. So. Yeah. Who couldn't follow them?
And let's play another track from the new album. This is called Always More, where I sense a little bit of a Buzzcocks sort of influence.
Yeah.
They were probably contemporaries of Subway Sex, weren't they? One of the very, very
first. They were one of the good, one of the one first good ones band, around at that time. That first EP they had was fantastic.
Good pop songs.
Says, can we just be friends? But there's always more. Here we go to the bitter end. But there's always more. Existential understanding. Where's the key to your door? Do as thou only will. Be the only law. There's always more. But there's always more. Think I know the score. I can't take what I always give. To the devil's claw, there's always more. But there's always more.
Always More from the new album If Only We'd Known. And next up we've got another influence, which is Roxy music. From listening to The Fallen Leaves, it's not a band that I would have thought that you would have cited as an influence. So why did you pick Roxy?
Unlike Rolf Harris, you mean?
Who's Rolf Harris, I can sort of understand totally now, after having spent some time with you.
I love early Roxy music.
They're very good, aren't they, as well? Very good.
I mean, I think, you know, I don't want to sound too... I'm a big fan, but not an uncritical one. Mm. And, you know, how lyrically those first three, particularly the first two albums, are pretty remarkable, I think. Mm. And they've just got that combination of being... And people have said this before. Well, I can remember seeing them on Top of the Pops. I think it was 1973, I think. Virginia Plain was on Top of the Pops, and I was absolutely blown away by it. Mm. And it was this mixture of being very, very modern, but also in a funny way, quite retro. And the way they mixed the two together just seemed to work. And I thought the imagery of it was fantastic. And it's a great, people forget, it's a great single with a very powerful guitar, Virginia Plain. Very, very powerful, and very simple. Mm. And I remember I heard Phil Manzanera, I saw a documentary about Roxy Music, and he said, after Eno left, it all became a bit too musical for him, and I know exactly what he means.
Well, it's true, isn't it? They lost that.
And the lyrics all became all not just so interesting anymore, and too musical, too technically proficient. Mm.
Yeah,
I can remember him saying in an interview at the time that he'd be playing things on his guitar, but there'd be completely different sounds coming out of the speakers because Eno would be fiddling around with the sound before it came out.
That's true.
But I was at school when they were first on the Over Whisters. My brother woke me up and said, quick, come downstairs, you've got to come downstairs.
Yeah.
And they looked fantastic because Brian played that time, had that huge sort of black
quick
with
his
straight back with a glitter jacket on. Phil Manzanera had those fly glasses on. The next day at school, everyone was talking about them, seeing them, and everyone bought that LP because the single wasn't on it. Yes, by the single came out. That's just that summer. It was just a great summer.
Yeah.
When we were just that right sort of age for listening to that. For me, they were the best of all of those groups.
Yeah.
So like Bowie or anything.
And people forget the Pistols were big fans of Roxy music, particularly Steve Jones. Steve Jones loved the Faces and Roxy music and the Who, I suppose.
There's no chorus of that song. It's just like
no. It's a strange song, isn't it?
It is a strange
song. It's not your classic single. Well, it's a classic single, but in terms of the makeup of it, it's
you
really
understand
weird,
what it's strange. Singing,
yeah,
it's strange one word.
Say that actually.
Yeah. Right, so let's hear Virginia Plain. This is Roxy Music's debut single.
Make me a deal and make it straight. Or sign and seal. I take it. Do rub it in the assurance. I hope that you don't blow it, cause we've been around a long time. Just try to make the big time.
In fact, if we can ask you what questions you should ask us, we've always wanted to be asked, what is the first single you ever bought? Because our two are particularly good. Right. Would you like to ask me what's the first single I ever bought, Steve?
Yes, please. What is the first single you ever bought?
The first single I ever bought...
I hope I've got it in my collection.
Well, the first single I ever bought was Al Capone by Prince Buster. On the Blue Beat label.
Al Capone, guns don't argue. We'll be right back.
And Rob also has a particularly good first record he bought.
I've listened to lots of music because I had all my brother's records, so I've grown up with all of those singers, but the first one I actually had myself was Where the White Swan, T-Rex. Yeah.
Riding on out like a bird in the sky, was riding on out like you were a bird. Flying on out like an eagle in a sunbeam, riding on out like you were a bird. Wear a tall hat like a druid in the old days, wear a tall hat and a tattered gown. Ride a white swan like the people of a bell chain. Wear your hair long, baby, can't go wrong. Catch a bright star and a place it on your forehead. Say a few spells and baby, there you go. Take a black cat and sit you on your shoulder, and in the morning you'll know all you know.
Now to finish off, let's play a classic Fallen Leaves track, one of the early numbers, High and Dry, and tell us a little
high
bit about this track.
High and Dry?
Yeah. Oh, not Higher and Drier, this is High and Dry. Yeah. This is, you know, this is the difference between the two, High and Dry and Higher and Drier. So tell us the difference between the two songs.
One is longer than the other. High and Dry is a bit
different
longer.
Bass player and drummer.
Different bass player, different drummer.
Yeah.
And this one was recorded live in Pete Townshend's studio in as long as you can hear it. It took 5 minutes to record.
Just did it with the vocals and everything.
And then we decided to do it again and call it Higher and Drier, and we did consider doing it a third time and calling it Highest and Driest, but we I think we forgot.
That was a superlative too far.
Yeah. Well, let's hear it. This is High and Dry.
Mystery. Oh, I may be
was High and Dry, and I'd just like to say a big thank you to the two Robs, Rob Green.
Thank you.
And Rob Simmons and Mr. Paul Slattery. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And don't forget to check out the Fallen Leaves, fallenleaves.net, for all your up-to-date news and information on their up-to-date website. But keep a check on the blog, and don't forget the 12 Bar Club.
First Wednesday of every month.
And have you got any gigs coming up soon?
Have we got anything else?
We've got Mark Riley on the 25th.
You've got the Mark Riley
session? Yeah, live show on BBC Six Music on March the 25th.
Is that actually going out live?
Goes out live. Right. We play live and it goes out live.
And what time's
7 o'clock.
It's 7 o'clock.
Mm. Great. We've got the 3rd of April will be the next 12 Bar Club. But yeah. I don't know whether we'll get all these things up on our website.
We'll carry them for you. Yeah. We'll carry the banner.
Well, we much appreciate your support. It's really important.
If I may say so, if I may be so bold, we walk those city streets, but they're not paved with gold. Oh, the sun keeps on shining, I got my feels so cold. If you're ancient or monger, if you're young or you're old, is this the after? Or is this before? Is this peace in our time? Or the brink of war? Oh, the sun keeps on shining, I've got my fist of cold. If you're ancient or mongrel, if you're young or you're old.
Spending having dinner with us, and I sat next to him. I had to say, was it true you were in the Wombles?
Yeah.
I had to ask him.
Was it true?
He sort of said, "Well, that's one rock and roll myth."
Chris was nice.
And they were there playing with Roxy Music.
Yeah. He's a good chap, Chris Spedding. Yeah.
And of course, I've got the. Do you remember that's
motorbiking?
Motorbiking.
Good single.
He was a Womble.
I think he was a Womble.
Those of his street could like motorcycle.
Uncle Bulgaria, that was my favourite.